Okay, so continuing on with this, very often we make shapes. We try not to make more shapes than we need, but it matters what order the shapes are in, like stacks of paper. So I'm gonna show you some of the ways you can move your layers around. So of course you can click on the layer and drag it and drop it. So down below that thumb shape, down below the hand shape. And of course I can select the layer I want by clicking on it, right? And I can hit Command T and I can warp out kind of a curve on that side of the hand and then tuck it in. And you can modify, and all of those are good skills that we've practiced before using Command T and modifying layers. But this project is different because we have so many layers. Each time we make a new shape, it will automatically make a new layer. So how best to move those kind of cutouts of paper through the system, down through? So first of all, how do you select your layers when you have so many layers? I like to use the Move tool with Auto Select checked for layer. And because I have this top layer locked, it won't ever select that one. So instead, it will select whatever shape layer that it happens to be on. Now notice that my top layer, the 20% opacity, shows me where the things overlap. And then I also have it open in preview over here. So it's clear that this shape needs to go over the top of this shape. So how can I move it? Well, I can drag and drop it, but it's even easier just to hit Command right bracket. So remember, we've had a few navigation shortcuts. Command plus zooms in, Command minus zooms out, Command zero fits it all in on the screen as large as possible, as long as it's the full file. Now, right underneath Command plus is Command right bracket. And Command right bracket will move a layer up through the stack until it's on top of absolutely everything. And Command left bracket will move it down. So that's going to be very helpful. Using the Move tool, I can click on that yellow, and now I can make a new ellipse, and it will be that yellow, because that's the last layer I was on. Then I can transform it and make the wrist out of it. And I can use my arrow keys if I don't want to drag and drop it. If I need more precise movement, I can use my arrow keys to do what's called nudging it into place. And so I've just created a pretty complex shape there out of three different yellow shapes, right? And we're not going for absolute perfection here, we're going for familiarity. Now if the transforms are too chunky, sometimes you have to zoom in to get more finesse, like so, and then hit return. So you can see those shapes, how they're working. And I can always turn off the top so you can see, and I can turn off my background by turn off the far background and just see what my shapes are by using my background fill. Now the problem is those shapes are all the same shape, or they're all of the same color, so they merge together, which makes sense. But what if I wanted to change the color on all of them? So if I want to get a little less particular, I might get off of the web colors, which especially in yellows do a disservice. And then I just double click on the layer icon, and then I can steal the color. From somewhere else. And now that I'm on those colors, I might as well do the other hand. I'll use a rounded rectangle tool this time, just to show you. And there are properties for the rounded, so if the rounded isn't all that rounded to you, you can change that here. So you can make that, you know, 40 pixels on all corners. And that's a little bit more noticeable. But of course, Command T will give you the ultimate control, especially when you right click within it and use distort to put your angles where you want them. So a nice wedge shape does a lot of that work for me. Using the same color, using another rounded rectangle, Command T just to transform it, push it down, cover the thumb. That does a lot. And then what if I want a triangle? I said I would show you how to do that. You won't see a triangle in the shape options, but you will see the polygon tool. So this is for any straight edged multi-sided tool. So I click on that, and then up at the top of the tools, you'll see a number of sides. So you can do 12 sides, you can do 8 sides, you can do 5 sides. I'm going to do 3 sides, and 3 sides is a triangle. And then I can Command T that and rotate it and put it in the right place and warp it to curve it to cover the thumb and the knuckle. And then am I going to do each little peak and valley of the knuckle? I can. I don't need to. It's what I think is necessary to describe the shape, right? But that doesn't need to be necessarily difficult. What if I just use an ellipse tool, make that shape, kind of move it into place, and then just duplicate it, Command J, and then carry that over. Duplicate it again, carry it over. Duplicate it again, carry it over. That can give me those peaks and valleys, right? That then I can individually transform if I need to. To help flow into the knuckles a little bit better. So a lot of this exercise is about transforming and just still playing with layers and understanding not just the order of the layers, but also their properties. The properties like their color, right? Really makes a difference. Then I'm going to do an oval for his head here. And this is where it gets a little bit difficult to keep everything within the parameters of the assignment, which is to keep everything as a shape tool, not to ever rasterize them and turn them just into pixels. So what if, for instance, I want to cut out that shape? I have to do it with another shape. I just have to overlap it with another shape. And in this case, I might use, let's see, maybe another ellipse, but then I have to warp it. This is kind of a moon shape, so this is a difficult shape to get, but it should be possible by warping that side, right? And now this is going to be a little cover. But first, let's change the color of it. And then I can transform it. I can make it bigger. I can rotate it. I can stretch it so it's a little bit shallower. And I can cut out the shape of that head, right? But now I need to move this shape back. So I'm going to use Command left bracket to move it down through underneath the hand, and then I'm going to take this layer and move it down underneath that mask. At the same time, I can soften this with warp, because my character is very, very lumpy. Lots of little curves. Doesn't mean I have to match all of them, but I want to get kind of the essence of them. Even this very clear rectangular, you know, knuckle guard looks just like a rounded rectangle, right? But because it's angled and in perspective, it's a little different. So I'm going to use warp and kind of push and pull it, curve it around, and then choose a color that's more appropriate. Yes. So to repeat the exact same shape, you just hit Command J. So I just made this shape. I need to, you know, make it red so it shows up. Then I need to hit Command right bracket to move it up above the knuckles. But let's say I want to repeat it exactly, right? Just Command J. Command J makes an exact copy in the exact same place so it doesn't look any different. But then if you use the Move tool, you'll have two of them. And then you can transform that. Now, artists generally use the same shapes over and over again. They just can't help it. You might notice that in your own drawing, in your own doodling. We have certain kind of favorite shapes and patterns. So instead of always choosing one from the preset shapes, you might just start altering shapes that you've already made to fill up your character. And in a lot of ways, it will give it a nicer rhythm. So for instance, I could just take that oval, Command J, use the Move tool to move it down because I have Move on auto select layer, and then Command T. And now this is the phase where I'm just trying to fill up the space, right? And if I'm on a deadline, I want to do that pretty quickly. So I'm not worried about little finesse or detail. I'm just trying to block out the composition. In commercial art, this is sometimes called a marker comp. And then the finished artwork just takes up the space of this blocking. And it's sometimes because you want to hire like a famous artist to do your ad campaign or your poster, but you have exact things that need to be on it. You need your beer bottle to be, you know, 70% of the image. And so you can't go to that famous artist or famous illustrator and just say, I want you to do whatever you want, because they might not make the beer the right size, right? So instead, you go to that artist and say, we'll pay you a whole lot, but you're just going to follow this composition, but make it as good as you can. And we're going to actually get a little bit of practice on that with our first assignment, because we're going to be making our own fantasy landscape, but I'm going to give you a composition based on an old public domain postcard. So the composition will already be given to you, but it will be like blocking like this, and you get to decide how to fill it up and make it your own. Actually, I kind of like that just as it is. All right. So imagine how difficult all of this would be if I had to go in and select each of these layers by scrolling through them each time. So having the Move tool set to auto select is definitely something I want you to learn from this. Okay, we're getting there. I don't know why I have this here. You can just hit delete to get rid of layers you don't need anymore. Remember, a wedge is a very helpful tool. You can just do it by doing a rectangle and then distorting it and bringing the corners in. It's like a triangle with its head cut off. And then that's a very versatile tool to adapt. Just Command J to duplicate it, and you can use it lots of places. And hopefully we're getting used to using the transform functions and then always